Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
The New Moral Code by Jeff Schweitzer and Giuseppe Notarbartolo-Di-Sciara. We each have within us the awesome power to pave our own road to a better life. Prologue. Challenging the status quo. The root of all superstition is that men observe when a thing hits, but not when it misses. Sir Francis Bacon. We are the masters of our own fate. Nothing is more powerful or more satisfying than this one simple truth. Living better is actually easy. We simply have to shed the constraints that keep us from achieving our goals. We need to let go. We need to let go of long-held assumptions that hold us back. A skydiver can never experience the joy of free flight if she never releases her grip from the safe embrace of the cabin. We all cling tightly to the familiar, like Linus to his blanket, but we can grow and prosper only by letting go of that which imprisons us with false comfort. Moses almost had it right when he said, "Let my people go." A simple plea to let go would have saved a few thousand years of angst. Learning how to let go is precisely what we teach. There is tremendous joy in realizing that life is not controlled by some unseen and mysterious force, but by an individual's own choices. There is incredible clarity in understanding that purpose and meaning in life are self-derived, and that these precious commodities are not some gift from above that can be taken away arbitrarily by a wrathful deity working in mysterious ways. We each contain within us the truly awesome power to pave our own road to a better life. You can harness that amazing power in just 3 steps. 1. Reject old assumptions about your limitations. You are master of your own fate. You can do more than you've done. 2. Discover within yourself your inherent good. Your moral core is yours. Find it, and then act on that better instinct. 3. Take full and complete responsibility for the choices you make. With freedom to create your own destiny comes the obligation to proceed sensibly. Our claim to the simple truth of self-empowerment, however, is not uncontested. Before we can fully embrace the 3 steps to personal freedom, we must first face the seemingly daunting task of moving a huge, stubborn boulder of change across a vast, open plain, unassisted by any mechanical advantage. As we struggle and push with our bare hands, we're reminded that the forces of the status quo are as powerful and as fundamental as the relentless pull of gravity. None of us like change. Comfort in the familiar is basic to our existence. We are all prone to wallowing in the thousands of reasons why we cannot accomplish our goal instead of finding the one reason we can. Entrenched interests and established institutions will work mightily to resist change and preserve the current order no matter the cost to current or future generations. And that cost is high. We are just shy of descending into another dark age in which ignorance and faith triumph completely over reason and fact. Ignorance is the enemy of personal freedom. Nowhere is this appeal to ignorance seen more clearly than in how society has reacted to the issue of climate change. Depending on the year measured, somewhere around 40% of Americans believe that climate change is exaggerated or a hoax. The number of Americans who agree that the scientists are correct about our climate predicament hovers near 55%. When the floods of famine come, our heirs will be paying dearly for the colossal foolishness of their parents and grandparents. But global warming is not the point. We will fight that battle elsewhere. Climate change is important here only in that the debate reveals something important about us beyond the potential for rising seas. We have entered a time in which scientific illiteracy has reached that catastrophic point where science transmutes from a search for objective truth to just another opinion, carrying no more weight than the blathering of a talking head with an opposing view. This cannot be denied when the collective opinion of thousands of professional meteorologists have been equated to nothing more valid than the uneducated opinion of a radio host. Such false equivalency is a sure sign we are in deep trouble. But really, this blindness to reality is not surprising. Society is mired in the consequences of an archaic moral code incapable of handling the demands of modern life, or the impacts of global industrialization. We stick our heads in the sands of religious intolerance and unreason. We have been here before. In 1612, Galileo encountered powerful opposition to his view that the sun was the center of the solar system. Based on his observations, Galileo claimed that the Earth revolved around the sun, a conclusion that was in direct contradiction to the teachings of the Church. His idea also contradicted the widely accepted world system proposed by Aristotle in the 4th century BCE, and later refined by Ptolemy. Galileo was simultaneously challenging the orthodoxy of the Church and the revered Greeks. Not only was Galileo attacking the concept that the Earth was the center of the universe, he was at the same time dethroning the idea that humankind was sitting at a special place in the cosmos. Both his intended idea and the logical consequences of his conceptual framework were a threat to established authority and a direct challenge to a central tenet of the Catholic Church. The iron-fisted resistance that Galileo encountered when confronting entrenched religious authority is relevant to our efforts today to articulate a new foundation for moral behavior divorced from any religion or God. A small detour describing Galileo's fate will help us put in historic context our current efforts to challenge long-established dogma. The link between morality and religion has been established so firmly over the past 2,000 years that any shift to a strictly secular model will strike many as heretical even today, on par with Galileo's transgression. That is so in spite of the long history of secular moral theories challenging religion over the past few hundred years. None of those challenges has been too successful. Life in the 21st century offers no refuge. Religious authority is not to be questioned. Just the act of publishing some cartoons critical of a prophet caused riots worldwide and dozens of deaths. In the United States, the religious right has hijacked the Republican Party, creating what is close to a theocracy, one that seeks to impose on the general population a narrow, intolerant religious moral code. Galileo's observations were a significant threat to the world order because he verified by direct observation the heretical ideas put forth by Copernicus 70 years earlier in The Revolution of Heavenly Bodies, published shortly after Copernicus died in 1543. The Church was not amused by Galileo's advances in astronomy or by his support of Copernicus. In 1614, Father Tommaso Cassini denounced the opinions of Galileo in the Church of Santa Maria Novella, claiming Galileo's ideas about the movement of the Earth to be false. Galileo went to Rome to defend himself against Cassini's charges, but to no avail. In 1616, Galileo was formally admonished by Cardinal Bellarmine and told that he could not defend Copernican astronomy because such teachings went against the doctrine of the Church. The Church's opposition to Galileo was no surprise given earlier and predictable reactions to Copernicus. Upon hearing the views proposed by Copernicus, Luther remarked at a dinner in 1539 that this fool, sometimes translated as that fellow, wishes to reverse the entire science of astronomy, but sacred scripture tells us that Joshua commanded the sun to stand still and not the earth. Rarely has an epithet been so far off the mark, for Copernicus possessed one of the greatest minds of his times. Such is the blinding power of religious fervor. In spite of a growing body of religious opposition, Galileo obtained permission to publish his ideas when his friend and supporter, Maffeo Barberini, became Pope Urban VIII. The Pope insisted only that Galileo would, in addition to presenting his heliocentric theory, put forth as well all the evidence to support prevailing dogma that the Earth was at the center of the solar system. As promised, in his book, Dialogue Concerning the Two Chief World Systems, published in 1632, Galileo presented the religious position, but he carefully and convincingly demonstrated with science and mathematics that the Church's view was not supportable by any evidence. The character Galileo used in the dialogue to support the Church's view was named Simplicio, a not too subtle slight, and Urban VIII suspected that this imperial and slightly ridiculous character was loosely based on none other than himself. For good reason, too, for Galileo used Simplicio to argue the point about God's omnipotence made by Barberini himself in previous discussions with Galileo. Adding further insult to the Church, the book was written in Italian, not Latin, in order to increase readership. Galileo was subsequently arrested for this work in October that same year under the all-encompassing charge of heresy. The Pope became one of Galileo's harshest and most unforgiving critics. His pride was wounded. The wording of the document condemning Galileo is a powerful testament to the dangers of dogma. "We say, pronounce, sentence, and declare that you, Galileo, by reason of these things which have been detailed in the trial and which you have confessed already, have rendered yourself, according to this holy office, vehemently suspect of heresy, namely, of having held and believed a doctrine that is false and contrary to the divine and holy scripture, namely, that the sun is the center of the world and does not move from east to west, and that one may hold and defend as probable an opinion after it has been declared and defined contrary to holy scripture. Under threats of torture and death, an unpleasant fate to consider, the Inquisition forced Galileo to renounce his views and to make a public statement that the earth stands still and that the sun revolves around the earth. He complied in order to avoid burning at the stake and wrote the requisite abjuration. The boilerplate language in his retraction is revealing in light of Galileo's clear understanding that the earth moves around the sun. I abjure with a sincere heart and unfeigned faith these errors and heresies, and I curse and detest them as well as any other error, heresy, or sect contrary to the Holy Catholic Church. And I swear that for the future I shall neither say nor assert orally or in writing such things as may bring upon me similar suspicions. And if I know any heretic or one suspected of heresy, I will denounce him to this holy office, or to the inquisitor or ordinary of the place in which I may be. So Galileo not only submitted to the church, he basically agreed with this language to become a snitch. Yet when submitting this strongly worded retraction, in which he affirms the church's view that the earth remains motionless at the center of the universe, he is said to have muttered, "E pur si muove," nevertheless, it moves. Historians of Galileo doubt seriously he actually uttered this phrase, but the story, whether factual or not, has taken on significance as a metaphor for the struggle between the search for truth and religious dogma. Considering the powerful forces arrayed against him and the horrific consequences of being condemned, Galileo's mumbled and perhaps apocryphal insistence that data must be evaluated objectively provides inspiration even today. By rejecting prevailing views, and by relying instead on careful collection and analysis of data, Galileo helped revolutionize scientific inquiry to a profound degree still felt 4 centuries later. Galileo, however, was not infallible, nor are the methods he introduced without flaws. His extreme confidence in his powers of observation led him to mischaracterize Saturn's rings with great authority. He later revised his views based on observations made more than 2 years later, but never did properly describe the rings. Rings were simply not in his worldview, and his mind was constrained to interpret what he saw in context of what he thought was possible. Galileo's failure to recognize the Saturnian ring system teaches each of us that even our most deeply embedded assumptions must be questioned as we examine the foundations of morality. In spite of his fallibility, Galileo's example illustrates the great potential of the human mind and the greatness of the human spirit when freed from the tyranny of dogma. His understandable capitulation to the forces of the Inquisition also served to remind us of ever-present and often intense pressures to accept prevailing views simply because such views are widely held. Introduction. An urgent need for a new moral code. D'où venons-nous? Que sommes-nous? Qu'allons-nous? From where do we come? What are we? Where are we going? Paul Gauguin, 1897. Which means, from where do we come? What are we? Where are we going? Paul Gauguin, 1897. As a minor branch on a vast evolutionary bush, modern humans have been roaming the earth for no more than a few 100,000 years of the earth's 4.5 billion year history. Ours has been a brief presence, with too little time to demonstrate if the evolution of large brains is a successful strategy for long-term survival of the species. Human beings are not inevitable, and our brief existence is not preordained to be extended into the distant future. If Homo sapiens is to have a continued presence on Earth, humankind will reevaluate its sense of place in the world and modify its strong species-centric stewardship of the planet. Our collective concepts of morality and ethics have a direct impact on our species' ultimate fate. We will adopt a new moral code if we are to survive. As are all creatures, humans are a genetic experiment resulting from selective pressure, random mutations, and pure chance that our ancestors avoided extinction from catastrophic events such as meteorite impacts. Our ancestors made it far enough to yield us, but the prospects for our future survival are not particularly bright. In the book Extinct Humans, authors Ian Tattersall and Jeffrey Schwartz note that extinction is the biological norm. So far, at least, the pattern of evolution for humans is no different from the rest of the Earth's fauna. Humans are certainly unique, with our combined abilities to reason, to communicate with complex language, and to modify our environment on a global scale. But cheetahs are unique, too, in their ability to run over 100 kilometers per hour, or 60 miles per hour. Sperm whales alone can dive to 2,000 meters, nearly 6,100 feet, on a single breath. And hummingbirds are the only aviators that can hover in midair, shift sideways, and fly backwards by flapping their wings up to 200 times per second while precisely controlling the wing's angle of attack. Specialized bugs live in deep sea volcanic thermal springs in temperatures up to 113 degrees centigrade, 235 degrees Fahrenheit, where no other creatures on Earth could survive. Each species, including humans, occupies a special place on the evolutionary bush according to its unique characteristics. Humans happen to possess a well-developed central nervous system as one of our defining traits, and this evolutionary development has provided us with the ability to contemplate ourselves and our future. But large, complex brains are simply another extreme in the development of animal traits, just as speed and strength are found in extremes in other animals. Our large brains do not confer upon us any special status among our living cousins, and it is the height of folly to claim that evolution was driven toward humans as the pinnacle of achievement. One could claim with equal validity that evolution advances toward a pinnacle of speed, or that bacteria are the perfect creation because only they can occupy extreme conditions of temperature, salinity, pressure, and acidity. The evolution of large brains confers no exalted status on the human race. But unlike cheetahs or bacteria, our particularly notable evolutionary achievement enables us to reason and communicate, and we, therefore, have a monopoly on making any claims about our status in the world. This monopoly has led to the self-serving and comforting conclusion that humans are somehow separate from and superior to the rest of the animal kingdom. The long-term survival of our species may require that we change this perspective. In an oft-told story, a group of ministers asked the famous scientist J.B.S. Haldane to characterize God based on Haldane's knowledge of the natural world. He replied that God apparently has an inordinate fondness for beetles. He had this opinion because about 20% of all known species of animals in the world are beetles. But even in his great wisdom, Haldane was wrong. God apparently has a greater propensity for prokaryotes, organisms comprised of just one cell, so small they can be seen only in powerful microscopes. While our sensitivities may be offended, we are living not in the age of man, but in the age of bacteria and archaea, or bugs, as they are generically known. These single-celled germs are the most successful of all life forms, and have been dividing away for more than 3 billion years. Bacteria have been found to live in virtually every conceivable environment at extremes of pressure, temperature, salinity, radiation, alkalinity, and acidity. A spoonful of good quality soil may contain 10 trillion bacteria, representing more than 10,000 different species. More than 1 million bacteria are found in 1 milliliter of seawater, and these constitute most of the ocean's biomass. The ocean holds many drops. Even more abundant by number in the ocean's waters are viruses, packing in roughly 10 million per milliliter. That means that viruses lock up as much as 270 million tons of carbon, more than 20 times the estimate for the amount stored in the Earth's supply of whales. Unwittingly referring to bacteria, Matthew 5:5 says that, "Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth." And indeed they shall. For regardless of the fate of humanity, bacteria will likely survive. The urgent question becomes, For how long can we delay or prevent that fateful day when humans, and perhaps all mammals, are just another extinct evolutionary experiment while bacteria continue their unparalleled dominance? Even acknowledging the obvious success of bacteria, changing our perspective toward a more humble understanding of the status of humans in the living world will be difficult. For millennia, people of nearly all cultures have been taught that humans are special in the eyes of their god or gods, and that the world is made for their benefit and use. This is made clear in Genesis 1:1, which states, God said, "Let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living creature that moves on the ground." We should pause here to raise three important points. First, citing passages from Genesis does not mean to imply that all religions everywhere support a species-centric viewpoint, or suppose that humankind occupies an exalted status. However, the focus is on the Judeo-Christian worldview because of its pervasive and widespread practice in the Western world. Second, the goal of this introduction is not to attack or to denigrate religion. The point is to illustrate beyond any doubt the fallibility of religious doctrine, and from that, demonstrate the fallibility of religious morality. By necessity, the foundation of morality as practiced today must be questioned if we are challenging the validity of that moral code, with a goal of demonstrating that morality must ultimately be divorced from religion and God. Third, as we explore further the impact of religious morality on society, we will focus much of the discussion on the Catholic Church, but only as a representative of religion, not as the only problem. With over 1 billion followers baptized globally, the Church's version of religious morality remains a powerful force in societies around the world. But by no means is the Church alone in promoting a false and dangerous moral code. Evangelical Protestants in the United States pursue a moral agenda that attacks gays, women, and minorities. Now firmly established in power in all branches of government and in the majority of state capitals, evangelicals work hard to limit a woman's right to choose her own reproductive destiny. They support the death penalty even when DNA evidence has, since 1989, exonerated 172 prisoners condemned on death row. Apparently, the sanctity of life has its limits. Evangelical Protestants deny the reality of climate change and allow industry to dump more poisons into the air and water, perhaps in hopes of accelerating the arrival of the apocalypse. They relentlessly insert their particular brand of religion into public life, fighting for school prayer and the teaching of intelligent design in public schools. The religious right wing willingly erodes the separation of church and state, supporting the display of the Ten Commandments on government property, and promoting government-funded faith-based initiatives. The inmates have taken over the asylum. Radical Islam is certainly no better, relegating women to nothing but chattel while spreading terror globally. The consequences of religious fervor were seen clearly on September 11, 2001. Those 3,000 people died a horrible death in the name of religious morality imposed by extremists. The hijackers objected to Western moral decadence and the infiltration of horrible ideas like equality for women into their medieval societies. Exhibit A on the list of Islamic countries that institutionalized the degradation of women is Pakistan, our stalwart ally in the fight on terror. Citing Islamic law, General Zia-ul-Haq mandated in 1979 that the responsibility for proving rape rests with the victim, who will otherwise be punished by death for adultery. To prove rape, the victim must produce 4 male or 8 female witnesses to the crime. In 2002, in Charlaki, Pakistan, Zafran Bibi was repeatedly raped by her brother-in-law and from that bore his child. For her crime, she was sentenced to death by stoning for being raped. Any disagreement with Islamic doctrine can mean death. In Afghanistan, Abdul Rahman was sentenced to die for the crime of converting to Christianity. This example of extreme intolerance is mainstream throughout the Islamic world. The Sharia, or Islamic law, states that a Muslim who abandons his faith can receive the death penalty. The Afghan constitution, based on Islamic law, embraces that concept. International pressure forced the Afghan government to exile rather than execute Rahman. We are not picking on the Catholic Church. The ideas we discuss next, using the church as an example, apply broadly across all monotheistic religions. Now, let's return to Genesis. The biblical passage referred to earlier gives humans the special status of being made in God's image, unlike any other creature on earth, and clearly implies human dominance over all other living things. Humans are told to subdue the earth and rule over the air, land, and sea. These religious teachings not only condone, but actively encourage humans to view the environment as separate from them, put here for their pleasure. In this worldview, no deep moral obligation exists to preserve resources for future generations. The explicit religious mandate to exploit natural resources remains clear and unambiguous, in spite of recent efforts to harmonize religion and environmental sciences by numerous academic and international organizations, including the Forum on Religion and Ecology, the largest international multi-religious project of its kind, and the Pontifical Academy of Sciences, founded in 1936 by the Vatican to promote scientific progress compatible with the Church's teachings. The argument used by those seeking reconciliation between religion and environmental protection point to the integrity of all creation, or reverence for all things created by God, insisting that religion and concern for the environment are not only compatible, but have been so all along. Those are welcome sentiments. In fact, as is frequently the case, the Bible contains contradictory passages about the natural world, reasonably allowing for such an interpretation. Old passages can simply be reinterpreted to fit the facts or to be compatible with newly adopted ideas. Pope John Paul XXIII said in 1961, "Genesis relates how God gave two commandments to our first parents, to transmit human life, increase and multiply, and to bring nature into their service, fill the earth and subdue it. These two commandments are complementary. Nothing is said in the second of these commandments about destroying nature. On the contrary, it must be brought into the services of human life." But the harsh facts of human history belie this benign revisionist interpretation of the meaning of subdue. The preponderance of unambiguous passages in the Bible giving mankind dominion over nature's bounty argues against any idea that religion is environmentalism in disguise. As Renaissance scholar Lynn White famously wrote in 1967, "We shall continue to have a worsening ecological crisis until we reject the Christian axiom that nature has no reason for existence save to serve man." His words remain true 40 years later, when religious conservatives in the United States view resource extraction as an inalienable right. Our natural resources are under growing threat from a torrent of new laws that encourage mining on federal land, weaken protection for species, habitat, and wetlands, accelerate deforestation, and promote drilling for oil in the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge, one of Earth's few remaining pristine areas. Then there is the biblical admonition to increase in number to fill the earth. When written, in times when death rates were high, the population small, and resources abundant, this mandate was easily justified. With over 6 billion people now calling Earth home, the divine mandate to multiply might now be viewed in a different light from when promulgated millennia ago. Yet the church remains unyielding. The official church position was reaffirmed in 1995 by Pope John Paul II, who condemned all artificial contraception as a conspiracy against life. To their credit, 80% of Catholic couples in their reproductive years ignore the Pope on this issue. Sex provides a powerful incentive to discount the ramblings of a celibate old man. But the church's position has real and tragic consequences, even if the laity rebel. In Latin America and Africa, bishops officially object to the use of condoms, instead recommending abstinence to prevent AIDS. The bishops steadfastly hold this view even in sub-Saharan Africa, where 26 million people are infected with AIDS, and more than 3 million more new infections occur each year. In Zambia, nearly 20% of the adult population is infected. Still, the bishops loyally follow the Pope's mandate. But a rapidly spreading AIDS epidemic is certainly not the only consequence of religious morality imposed on the question of family planning. Unwanted pregnancies in poor countries condemn women to an unrelenting cycle of poverty. Only when women gain control over their reproductive destiny and have access to education can that cycle be broken. But the Church, with a concerted campaign against condom distribution, actively seeks to prevent women from gaining such control. This policy contributes directly to the suffering of millions of people relegated to hunger, disease, and illiteracy. The war against contraception, without concern for short-term suffering and the long-term consequences for human survival, is another sign that religious morality is deeply and tragically flawed. Beyond policy errors, such as obsolete ideas of family planning, scientific discoveries over the past 2,000 years have proven many biblical assertions to be factually in error. Let us come back to the Church's insistence that the earth was the center of the universe as another example of how the supposedly infallible and eternal teachings of the Holy Scriptures are not. 359 years after Galileo's conviction, the Pope issued in 1992 a statement acknowledging that the Church's prosecutors did not interpret with great circumspection the biblical passages that declare the earth immobile. This linguistic contortion attempts to show that the Bible was not wrong, but simply that the Bible was not interpreted with appropriate clarity during the Inquisition. But the Bible was and is utterly clear in stating that the earth is immobile and that the sun revolves around the earth. Referring to the sun, Psalm 19:6 says, "His going forth is from the end of the heaven, and his circuit unto the ends of it, and there is nothing hidden from the heat thereof." The Psalms also say, 104:5, that "he established the earth upon its foundations, so that it will not totter forever and ever." Solomon, speaking from divine inspiration in Ecclesiastes 1:5-6, claims, "The sun riseth and goeth down, and hasteth to his place, and there rising again, maketh his round by the south, and turneth again to the north." Joshua 10:13 states the following, "And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed, until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies." Is not this written in the book of Jasher? "So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven, and hasted not to go down about a whole day." If any doubt remains, the Church claimed the following in Galileo's abjuration, a doctrine that is false and contrary to the divine and holy Scripture, namely that the sun is the center of the world and does not move from east to west. For more than 1,600 years, the Church denied any ambiguity in this view, vigorously defending as indisputable divine fact the notion that the earth was the immobile center of the universe. Galileo was to burn at the stake for questioning this divine fact. The Church held on to geocentrism tenaciously until contrary evidence became irrefutable. The solution to this glaring discrepancy between fact and Scripture was to suddenly declare that nothing in Scripture requires the earth to be the center of the universe, thereby sweeping 1,600 years of violently enforced dogma under the rug. That is quite a broom and a mighty big rug. Even today in the 21st century, the Church claims that Galileo shares blame because he made unproven assertions. The best the Pope could muster was that he regretted the tragic mutual incomprehension that had caused Galileo to suffer. As the new millennium settles in, the Church still claims that Galileo was wrong. The dissonance between Scripture and fact is not a problem relegated to earlier centuries, but remains relevant today. The Bible's clear statement about the age of the earth, off by more than 4 billion years, is another example of an important factual error. This error, of course, has implications for creation. also related to the church's view on creation, the Pope in 1996 was able to admit only that evolution is more than just a theory. With each new discovery proving a biblical assertion wrong, the church retreats to the safety of errors in interpretation or dismissing the discrepancy as unimportant. Yet these accumulating factual mistakes must call into question the certainty with which the church claims the Bible is infallible, since their previous insistence has proven unsubstantiated. These doubts about infallibility apply, too, to the church's teachings on morality. That religious morality has failed is made clear by humanity's current fate and the sad state of the planet. Religion has had 2,000 years to prove itself worthy as a guiding moral force. Yet the result of that 2,000-year experiment is war, poverty, hunger, and suffering across the globe as humanity consumes itself. In addition, after two millennia, we see overpopulation, depletion of non-renewable resources, and accelerated degradation of the environment because our current moral foundation is not suited to guide us away from that destruction. Long-term survival of humankind may depend on our ability to define a new moral code that adapts the human species to the demands of the future, completely independent of God and religion. A distinction must be made here that is explored in greater detail later in the book. Long-term survival of the species is not a motivation for adopting a new moral code, but a possible consequence of doing so. If humankind's welcome on Earth is to prove sustainable, and if large brains are indeed adaptive, we will re-examine our responsibilities toward each other and understand better our dependencies on the physical world around us and the resources that support our existence. Just like all other beings, humans follow the rules of nature. Now, if we are to take another path, one unique to our species, we must decide for ourselves on the basis of a deliberately chosen model within the constraints of nature. What is that other path? All species exploit the environment to the maximum extent possible until competition, predation, resource depletion, disease, or other constraints limit growth and expansion. Social animals, from insects to mammals, find equilibrium between cooperation and competition among conspecifics and potential enemies. Human survival strategies are little different from those pursued by other species, except that we have a huge technological advantage. In struggling to survive, humans have successfully co-opted a significant percentage of the planet's available resources and alternately waged war and pursued peace within and between societies. Our reliance on technology to exploit resources and each other has had global effects over a short time period, unlike other species similarly striving to survive. As a result, our efforts to survive and prosper may have the paradoxical consequence of causing our extinction, either directly through the use of weapons of mass destruction or through the degradation of the resources on which we depend. Fortunately, the large brains that gave us technology and war also give us the ability to choose, personally and collectively, to behave for the greater good and to be concerned with the fate of distant generations. Humans have a unique capability, even if not always realized, to worry about the fate of the planet. With our large brains, we find ourselves contemplating an important crossroad in our evolutionary history. Do we continue plodding along like all other species, exploiting resources and each other to the maximum extent possible, blindly marching toward our own extinction? Or do we rise to the occasion and grab the opportunity unique to our species? Humans are special not because we are made in God's image and told to rule over the earth, but because we have the amazing potential to choose a future in which we thrive and develop in a just society while coexisting with a natural, healthy world. If we fail to seize our opportunity to create such a future, we will be no more than bacteria with library cards. The choice is in our hands, not God's. We are special if we choose to be, if we ourselves decide to use our big brains to manage wisely our relationships with one another and with our environment. That is the essence of a new moral code, and that is the new path. We can choose to rise above the common destiny and course of other species and realize the full potential of being human. This book sets out to define a moral code based on a fundamental shift in our perception of place in the world, and to contrast this new philosophy to extant beliefs and practices. This new moral code, and what we call a natural ethic, which can be defined briefly as the freedom to discover within ourselves our inherent good, and then to act on that better instinct because we can. A natural ethic is pursued without ulterior motive for personal gain in this life or in the hereafter. This new moral code is sought not in fear of punishment nor in search of reward, but is sought for no reason other than it is what makes us human. The first important step is to demonstrate that a new moral code must be divorced from God and religion. The notion that morality and ethics do not derive from religion is not new. Over 200 years ago, the English philosopher David Hume dedicated himself to showing that moral life can be lived and fully explained without the resources of religion, and free of any reliance on divine authority. This view is uplifting, positive, and above all, human. It may also be essential to the survival of our species. But separating ethics from religion is just the first step in pursuit of a new moral code, albeit an extremely important one. We must go further and remove any motive for self-reward in moral behavior, and we must reevaluate the place of humanity in our physical world as a moral imperative. All of these elements and their interrelationships will be explored in depth in the following chapters. Part 1. Embracing a New Moral Code. How to let go of old constraints to realize life's full potential. Chapter 1. Motivations for Moral Behavior. I believe in Spinoza's God. Albert Einstein. We are taught from an early age that moral behavior is desirable as a ticket to heaven, and as a means of avoiding the agony of eternal damnation. Morality, according to these teachings, is not an obligation or a characteristic inherent to humankind, but something to be cynically manipulated for other gains or bartered in exchange for bad behavior. This concept of morality for sale is now so deeply embedded into the fabric of our society that the underlying premise is rarely challenged, and only at great risk to those who dare. Along with that unquestioning acceptance comes the notion that the Bible is the primary, if not sole, source for this moral guidance. Yet the Bible is nothing of the sort. Only the most selective reading of the text could ignore the preponderance of jealous, hateful, wrathful, bloody, murderous, spiteful, mean-spirited, and vengeful proclamations from God. He is not a good role model. That statement requires some explanation and background. Religious morality is based on the idea that God reveals to humankind how to live through His word as laid down in the Holy Book. The Bible is the instruction manual to life. Just as one would expect the captain of a Boeing 747 to have read the operations manual for his airplane before departing with 300 passengers in tow, one would assume that most Jews and Christians would have read cover to cover the source document on how to live a good life. Not so. Surprisingly, few people professing a belief in God have read the entire collection of 66 books constituting the Bible. Anecdotally, the number is well under 10%, although the actual number is notoriously difficult to pin down. That ignorance of the actual text might explain why a 2006 Gallup poll revealed that more than 30% of Americans believe the Bible to be the literal Word of God. Only by not reading the document could the glaring inconsistencies and incongruities be readily ignored, which they must be if God is to remain an infallible moral counselor. Nevertheless, whether based on reading the Bible or not, a substantial number of the faithful believe the book to be literally true. So let's look at what the God of Abraham has to say about morality in his own words. Perhaps most striking is that slavery, incest, rape, polygamy, and misogyny are fully condoned and encouraged by God, literally. In Genesis 4:19, we are told that Jacob had two wives. Solomon was busier with 700. In Genesis 16:2, Sarah gave permission to Abraham, her husband, to have sex with her maid, Hagar. Of course, since Hagar was a maid, she did not need to consent to this relationship. So Sarah gave Abraham permission to rape Hagar so that she could act as a surrogate egg source. Genesis 19:8 tells the story of how some friends of Lot, men from Sodom, were sitting around his house when those friends decided they would like to gang rape two female guests that Lot was hosting. But no, having a sense of decorum, Lot instead offered up his two daughters for the evening's activities. "I have two daughters which have not known man. Let me, I pray you, bring them unto you, and do ye to them as is good in your eyes." Such an action was perfectly acceptable because women were nothing but property to be used at will. Note that Lot said which and not who in reference to his daughters. Genesis 19:30 goes on to tell us more about Lot, who was not satisfied with serving up his daughters for rape. Lot himself subsequently had sex with both. Each became pregnant as a result, each giving birth to a son. None of this is condemned in any way by God. God makes clear throughout the Bible his view that women are unclean and the source of man's biggest woes. God's brutal treatment of women must bring into question his judgment if the Bible is the direct word of the Almighty. Ecclesiastes 25:18 claims that sin began with a woman, and thanks to her, we all must die.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.